Hi, my name is Lin Lu, and welcome everyone to the talk of our CTRSA 2022 paper on fingerprinting attacks and lens hiding encryption. This is joint work with Kai Gellert, Tibor Jager, and Tom Newshutin. We are from the University of Wuppertal. Let me start with an overview of the problem we studied. It has been long known that message lens can be leaked even if the message is encrypted. In the real world, message lens leakage is so common that it even became an important side channel to many attacks. For example, a webpage fingerprinting attacker can exploit webpage lens information to identify the webpage visited by a user through the encrypted network traffic without breaking the encryption scheme. Similar ideas can be used to identify users in TLS encrypted sessions based on the user's password length. In the voice over IP scenario, languages and phrases can be detected even if the conversation is encrypted properly. And unfortunately, many other examples exist. In our work, we are particularly interested in the fingerprinting attacks. One important countermeasure to the fingerprinting attacks is the lens-hiding encryption proposed by Patterson, Ritz-Tempard, and Shrimpton. They augment the encryption scheme with a lens-hiding parameter to prevent message lens leakage from ciphertext. This will block the side channel and significantly reduce the success probability of the fingerprinting attacker. Actually, lens-hiding encryption is already implemented in TLS 1.3, however, lens-hiding encryption is rarely enabled in the real world. One important reason is that people don't know how to choose a proper lens-hiding parameter for their applications. Another reason is that many people believe that significant efficiency loss will be incurred by enabling the lens-hiding encryption. In our work, we propose a novel perspective for lens-hiding encryption and fingerprinting attacks. We first propose a new perspective for lens hiding parameter. This gives us freedom to consider messages of any length. Then we consider concrete security instead of achieving negligible advantage for all PPT adversaries in the asymptotic security setting. This gives us freedom of achieving a reasonable security instead of perfect security, where no information of length is leaked at all for all messages. We provide a new methodology to concretely quantify the effect of different choices of length-hiding parameter L so that we could do comparison between different choices. In this way, we can choose proper length-hiding parameter for different applications with different message distributions. And finally, we show the feasibility of our approach by applying it to different types of fingerprinting attacks. First, let's see how the message length are taken care of in theory. We know that any encryption scheme which encrypts bit strings of any length and with perfect correctness, the ciphertext of any message must contain all the information of that message, so that when the ciphertext is decrypted, the original message will be recovered. Thus, it makes sense that the ciphertext is at least as long as the message. Furthermore, it also makes sense that ciphertext length grows with message length. So we can see that ciphertext length contains information about message length. However, in theory, message length is unprotected in standard security definitions for encryption schemes. The semantic security or private key encryption scheme is an example. In this setting, an adversary learns a ciphertext of some message M and would be able to correctly predict the information F of M with probability P. Semantic security guarantees that there is a simulator which can output F of M with approximately the same probability P prime, and the simulator does not see any ciphertext, but instead sees the message length. In other words, semantic security guarantees that an adversary can learn nothing about the message from the ciphertext except for the message length. Another example is the RDCPA security for public key encryption. In this setting, an adversary submits two messages of the same length after receiving the public key and gets back a ciphertext for one of the two messages, which is chosen uniformly random. and the adversary is not able to perform significantly better than random guessing with which message is encrypted. In other words, IND CPA security guarantees confidentiality for messages with the same length, but says nothing about messages of different lengths. Some previous efforts have been made in this direction. Tuscana and Wadney considered a stronger indistinguishability-based security where confidentiality holds for messages of different lengths as long as the length difference is bounded by some number delta. Very unfortunately, they show that a superpolynomial length padding has to be applied to the message before encryption in order to achieve this security, even only for the case of delta equals to 1. This suggests that in theory it is impossible to hide a message length efficiently and perfectly. And it supports the common belief that a considerable bandwidth overhead incurred by length hiding padding is inevitable. The length hiding encryption proposed by Patterson, Ritz-Tempard, and Shrimpton augments the classical encryption algorithm with a new input called the length hiding parameter, and it specifies the length of the ciphertext. This makes it possible to control the ciphertext length outside the encryption algorithm. In the security they consider, the adversary is allowed to choose two messages with arbitrary lengths and is allowed to choose the length hiding parameter L as long as it is an achievable ciphertext length for both of the two messages. For example, here we require that L is larger than the max length of M0 and M1. Secure length hiding encryption essentially protects the confidentiality of messages with different lengths as long as the corresponding ciphertexts have the same length. However, the length hiding encryption is rarely enabled in or used in the real world. The reason is that the responsibility comes with the freedom of controlling ciphertext length outside the encryption algorithm, and people simply don't know how to choose a proper length hiding parameter for their applications. Fixing a length hiding parameter means fixing the ciphertext length for all messages, and this restricts the upper bound of message lengths to be encrypted. So it makes sense to select a length hiding parameter which is larger than the length of the longest message in that application. This is super undesirable because many applications have no upper bound or very large upper bound for their message lengths, and encrypting every message, even only a single bit, to the length of a very large encryption length hiding parameter will impose significant bandwidth overhead and super undesirable efficiency loss. Next, let me show you our new perspective and methodology. Let me introduce our new perspective of length hiding parameter. Instead of viewing L as the total length of the ciphertext, we use padding before encryption and view L as only a parameter which determines the padding length. More precisely, consider a padding algorithm which makes a message M, which takes in a message M together with a parameter L, and always pad the message such that the length after padding is the next multiple of L. For example, if we consider a message length of length 90, and we pad this message using parameter 40, we will get a new message of length 120. And if we pad it using the parameter 50, we will get a new message of length 100. And of course, we can recover the original message from these new messages. We will call this L as the length hiding parameter, and we will fix the parameter L and apply padding algorithm with a parameter L to all the messages before encryption. This gives us freedom to choose L without worrying about the upper bound of the length of the message, so that there is no dependency between the length hiding parameter and the message distribution. Then we consider the scenario of web page fingerprinting attacks, where a user accesses to some web page through an encryption channel with a certain web server. The encrypted traffic is observed by the adversary, and the adversary wants to identify the web page visited by the user without breaking the security of the encryption scheme. We can see that fingerprinting attack has the following properties. First, the messages are public to the adversary since it can access to the web server itself. Second, the adversary has no control of the message distribution at all, since it is completely passive. Third, the adversary may or may not know the message distribution app. If the adversary has no information about the distribution M, it can assume that M is a uniform distribution over all the N pages. We capture a fingerprinting attack using a new security module shown here. We call it the INC-MF CCA security, where INC is the encryption scheme, M is some message distribution that may output messages of different lengths, and F is a function. In this security game, the adversary gets the challenge distribution and the function f. A fresh key k is generated and a message m is chosen according to the distribution m. Then the adversary gets the ciphertext for this message. Additionally, the adversary has access to an encryption oracle and a decryption oracle, which is not shown in this picture. The adversary could potentially gain more information about the message M through these oracles. And finally, the adversary wins if it can predict F of M. We think this model is simple and captures the simplest fingerprinting attacks very well, since the adversary has no control for the message distribution and only sees one ciphertext for the web page. And information F of M can be the URL of the web page or can be the web page itself. And we define the real success probability of an adversary A as the probability of A winning this game, and we want to reduce the probability as much as we can. We do this in two steps. We first consider an ideal game where the adversary does not have access to the encryption or decryption oracles, and also the adversary does not get the ciphertext, but only gets the length of the ciphertext as input. And the adversary wins if it can predict F of M correctly. We define the trivial success probability as the maximum probability that any adversary can win this ideal game. This trivial success probability actually captures the information leakage from only ciphertext length about the message M. We can prove that the real success probability of any adversary A is bounded by the trivial success probability plus the INDC CCA advantage of the encryption scheme. And this advantage is negligible if the adversary A is efficient and the encryption scheme is INDC CCA secure. The trivial success probability can be very large. For example, for some message distribution and some encryption scheme, the ciphertext length may completely determine the message so that the trivial success probability is 1. In this way, to reduce the real success probability for certain distribution M, we only need to choose a proper NDC CCA secure encryption scheme with small trivial success probability. Next, we show that the trivial success probability cannot be arbitrarily small because the adversary always has the message distribution. Consider this game where the adversary only gets the message distribution M and the function F as input and needs to predict F of M. We determine the most likely probability as the maximum probability of any adversary in winning this game. The most likely probability actually captures the information of the distribution and is a lower bound for the trivial success probability. Thus, we have that the trivial success probability must be in between of the most likely probability and 1, and the 1 encryption scheme is better than the other if its trivial success probability is closer to the most likely probability. To quantify this, we normalize trivial success probability and define the trivial advantage as trivial success probability minus the most likely probability divided by 1 minus the most likely probability. By definition, the trivial success probability is in between 0 and 1, where 0 means the optimal case, where no extra information about the message is leaked through the ciphertext length, and 1 means the worst case where the ciphertext length uniquely identifies the message. One benefit of defining the trivial advantage is that we can now compare between different lengths hiding parameters and see that L1 is better than L2 if the trivial advantage is smaller for L1. And next, we apply our methodology to different fingerprinting attacks. The first scenario we consider is very simple web page fingerprinting attack where a user visits one page of the IACR Cryptology ePrint Archive website in the year of 2020. This website is a public archive website hosted by the International Association for Cryptology Research. In the year 2020, 1,620 papers are uploaded to this website, and we assume the user accesses to one of them. We assume that the adversary has no information of which page is visited, so it assumes that the distribution of this page is chosen uniformly random out of these 1,620 pages. The adversary gets one ciphertext for this page and wants to tell which page the user is visited. We apply our methodology and calculate the trivial advantage for different length hiding parameters and different in different scenarios. The result is summarized in this table. We take the AES-GCM encryption scheme as the default setting, then we consider different combinations of length hiding parameter and whether compression before encryption is enabled. We calculate the trivial advantage for these combinations and also calculate the total amount of ciphertext data for all the 1,620 pages to be encrypted. And finally, we calculate the overhead compared with the default setting. The first row shows the default setting where both length hiding padding and the compression is turned off. In this case, we get the trivial advantage 0.74, which is close to 1. This indicates that a lot of information is leaked through the ciphertext length in this setting. If we use length hiding padding and choose L equals to 80 bytes, we can see that the trivial advantage drops to 0.0327. This is a significant improvement for reducing the length leakage. Furthermore, we only pay less than 1.158% data overhead compared with the default setting. If we further enable compression in this case, we can even save almost half of the communication data while reducing the trivial advantage to only less than 0.0142. If we choose a very large length hiding parameter, which is nearly 9,000 bytes in this setting, we get 158% overhead, but we can reduce the trivial advantage to exactly zero. If we further enable compression, we can achieve zero trivial advantage by only choosing L to be almost 3,500. Surprisingly, in this case, we even can save some data compared with the default setting. And this shows that we can perfectly defend the fingerprinting attack while saving some communication by using length hiding encryption and compression together. One limitation of this ePrint example is that we don't have any real-world distribution for ePrint website and only assume that it is a uniform distribution. The second scenario we consider is a fingerprinting attack for the Wikipedia website. The Wikimedia Foundation publishes page view statistics of Wikipedia website since May 2015. The page view statistics contain the number of requests for each web page in Wikipedia, and this provides us with a real-world message distribution for Wikipedia pages. We use the data of May 2021 to reconstruct the real distribution for 164,270 web pages written in simple English. Then we apply our methodology and calculate the trivial advantage for different lengths for different length hiding parameter and in different settings. The result is summarized in this table. You can see that the trivial advantage is 0.875 for the default setting, which is very large, and we can reduce it to zero, but have to pay a huge amount of data overhead when compression, even when compression is enabled. However, by setting L to 40,000 and enable compression, we can reduce the trivial advantage to less than 0.01 and save about half of the data at the same time. This is a nice result. However, I want to emphasize that the distribution we consider is here is actually not a real distribution for only one user, but a distribution for all users. This distribution is known to the web server, and our results show that the web server can help in defending fingerprinting attacks by selecting a suitable length hiding parameter. And actually, we are implementing this idea as a module of the Apache web server. Our implementation consists of two components. The first component monitors the server requests and responses to determine the distribution dynamically. The second component of our implementation computes the length hiding parameter based on this distribution and outputs the smallest L such that the trivial advantage is below a certain value. Our implementation is currently experimental, but it provides us good confidence that a web server can use little computational resource to compute a suitable length hiding parameter dynamically. We plan to continue working on this and provide a more suitable, stable version publicly available in the future. In our paper, we apply our methodology to some other fingerprinting scenarios. For example, we consider the scenario of ePrint web page fingerprinting with communication patterns. This means that the user not only visits the web page, but also downloads the PDF file contained in that page. In this way, the adversary sees two ciphertexts, one for the web page and the other one for the PDF file. This gives the adversary more information about which page the user visits. Another example is the Google search term fingerprinting scenario, where we assume the user searches some search term in the Google search engine, and the adversary sees the ciphertext for the result page. The adversary tries to identify which search term the user has searched. The third scenario is the DNS fingerprinting scenario, where the user sends DNS requests to a DNS server and gets back a response. The adversary sees both of the two ciphertexts and wants to know which website the user has requested. In all these three scenarios, we get similar results as the previous two scenarios. That is, we can choose a suitable length hiding parameter and get both low trivial advantage and the low communication overhead. Let me conclude this talk with a brief summary of our work. We provide a new perspective for length hiding encryption, which allows us to select a length hiding parameter depending on the application, and we develop a new methodology for evaluating the effectiveness of length hiding encryption against fingerprinting attacks. We apply our methodology to different fingerprinting scenarios to show its feasibility. And I want to emphasize that our work does not provide a perfect solution to the fingerprinting attacks, because the fingerprinting adversary in the real world can learn much more information than just the ciphertext length from all kinds of different channels. But we believe that most of these side channels can be eliminated technically. However, the length leakage cannot be easily removed. A concurrent work by Jan-Paul Digably in CCS 2021 studies a similar problem, but focuses on finding the effect of random length padding. For our perspective, his results do not conflict with our results for defending fingerprinting or other passive attacks, but his results provide a nice solution to defend against active attacks based on message lengths, like the compress then encrypt attacks. So this is all for my talk. If you are interested in our work, you can access to our paper via this link here. If you have any questions, feel free to contact us. And thank you very much for your time and attention.